Hey there, Pupsters. So, Apple's very special Hey Siri event just ended, and wow, did it impress. For the most part. Now, as you all know, Eman couldn't make it in today, so I'm gonna be saving most of my opinions for this Saturday's episode when we can both discuss with one another. But let's just jump right into what we found out today. Starting with the meat and potatoes, let's get through the Apple Watch and the Apple TV before we get into the really big, monstrous news with the iPad Pro and the iPhone 6S. So the Apple Watch had a couple of updates, including two new color options for the Watch Sport model, which includes rose gold and gold anodized aluminum. Apple also teamed up with a company called Hermes to come out with some new designery leather watch straps. Alongside this, they're also releasing a bunch of new color options for their regular straps, and the designer straps will be available in October, while the new bands and the new color option watches will be shipping out today. Alongside this, Apple also announced that watchOS 2 will be dropping to the public on September 16th. So keep your eyes open if you do use an Apple Watch. We kind of went over in detail what to expect with watchOS 2 during the WWDC video that we made. But some cool things that are coming out with are the Facebook Messenger will now be available on the watch itself, as well as a new GoPro app that allows you to use the watch as a viewfinder, which I found pretty cool. Now, of course, there was a lot more said about the Apple Watch, but I won't be going into detail. So if you do want the specifics, I will be leaving links in the description below. But let's move right along to the Apple TV. Now, this is where it kind of started to falter for me. Now, don't get me wrong. The Apple TV was pretty impressive when it comes to hardware. You know, it came with the A8 chip, which I'm assuming is not held back by power concerns because, there is no battery power. It's plugged into the AC unit. It came with a new remote, and as we had said, it was that black anodized design. It comes with a touchpad. It's Bluetooth connected now instead of IR, so you don't have to point it directly at the Apple TV to get, you know, the connection. You don't have to worry about that. It has motion sensors. Of course, it has the mic for the Siri implementation with the Apple TV, and also is rechargeable. It came with a lightning cable output, little input on the underneath the controller that you can charge, and it's supposed to last 30 days per charge. Along with that came the new tvOS, which will kind of change up the game for the Apple TV, allowing a new app store, interconnectivity where when you use Siri and searching for stuff, which was really cool when they would search for movies. It would come up with results from Hulu, Netflix, iTunes, HBO, and Showtime, and they announced that they're going to be coming out with different services as time goes on, and I'm assuming that's when they get in like things like CBS and the other TV networks that they're working with right now to come out with their, you know, TV streaming deal that they have with them. But now we get into some of the things that I thought they kind of did bad, which was the gaming looked awesome, but as a controller, that is a terrible controller for gaming, I gotta say. It seems it's a very tiny little touchpad that all you can do is little clicks and swipes, and that's about all you can do. And the other thing was that if you want to play with a friend, you either have to have an iPhone or an iPad with you to play, or an iPod Touch. What if the friends you want to play with are using an Android system? It kind of holds them back from that. I mean, that's not a big deal, but one of the other things that I didn't really like so much was the look of the new device. It's this weird, shrunk down, 10 millimeters taller, kind of cubish fat block now. Which was kind of weird. From the little mock-ups we saw of other people coming out with their designs, I really actually would have liked a thinner, kind of slightly puckish design thing that would have looked really nice. But besides that, it was still a pretty cool product, especially with some Siri integration that they had where you could search in for stuff like weather, pull in like game scores and stuff and have it swipe in, swipe out while you're watching your show so it doesn't really get in the way. They also brought in some app support like from MLB where you could pull in two games at the same time and watch them at the same time, you know, choosing which one so you could have, you know, screen and screen when I'm pretty sure this is coming with the new A8 processor being able to handle that information at once, which I'm pretty sure might be an issue with the older third gen Apple TV. I'm not sure how they're going to implement that since they're keeping that around. And all these new TV streaming stuff is supposed to be coming to the third gen Apple TV as well. So I'm pretty sure you're gonna have to move up to the fourth gen if you want these little capabilities and everything, especially with the Siri stuff. But anyway, it's coming out with two sizes. We had originally thought it would be 8 and 16, but it's actually 32 and 64 gigabyte models starting at $149 and the higher one being $199 in price. And both of these should be available at the end of October, and I will definitely be picking one up, so I will be giving a more in-depth review when those do become available. So let's move on to the news about the iPads. Now, before I get into the iPad Pro, let's first talk about the iPad Mini 4. Now, they didn't really make a big deal out of this. It was just kind of like a side thing, I guess, because of time or something, or maybe they just wanted to focus a lot on the iPad Pro. But the iPad Mini 4 is as we expected. It is the iPad Air 2 shrunk down into a mini-sized tablet, and that's all. It's just a smaller iPad Air 2. It seems they dropped the Mini 3 for the Mini 4. And so the lineup is gonna be the Mini 2, the Mini 4, the iPad Air regular, the iPad Air 2, and the new Pro models. So the iPad Pro. Now let's get the worst bit of news about this out of the way, and that's the price tag. Starting at $799 and going all the way up to $1,079. It is a bit steep, but from what they showed, it's kind of worth it. I mean, check it out. Like, the iPad Pro comes with a beautiful 12.9-inch, 2732 by 2048 Retina display that has more resolution than the 15-inch MacBook Pro Retina display. On top of that, it comes with this new quad setup of stereo speakers that is 3 times louder than the iPad Air 2. It also comes with the new A9X chip, which has double the bandwidth of the A8X chip, which gives it 80% faster CPU processing, 2 times the speed of GPU processing. I mean, this thing is a beast. And on top of that, it still has a 10-hour battery life. It only weighs 1.57 pounds, and it is less than 1 millimeter thicker than the iPad Air 2, coming in at 6.9 millimeters. Now, all this power really doesn't mean anything without app support, and Apple seems to be getting a lot of it. Both Microsoft and Adobe have jumped on board to come out with their own version of their apps, you know, Microsoft with Office, Adobe with their Creative Suite, and a couple of new apps as well, to be able to better handle the screen, as well as the new stylus that was announced at the show. And now this stylus is pretty awesome, although kind of poorly named as the Apple Pencil. Now the stylus is able to be simultaneously used as you're touching stuff on the tablet, as well as being able to detect the force and tilt of the pen itself. It also comes with a removable cap with a lightning cable underneath, so you can charge it up right there from your iPad Pro. Apple also announced a new smart keyboard for the iPad Pro. Now, it's not a Bluetooth keyboard like we originally assumed. It's actually connected via this new smart connector on the side of the iPad Pro. It's this three-prong connection where the keyboard actually touches on and power and data is transferred between it. Now, whether or not the iPad Pro will be a success remains to be seen. It is a pretty impressive piece of tech. I mean, it's really powerful, but I think it's geared a little bit more towards designers, editors, and the medical field. They had a great example of, I think it was 3D for medical. I mean, they showed a really impressive demo on how they can show a patient what's going on within their body in real-time 3D, 60 frames per second rendering of, you know, body parts and being able to show what's going on. You know, it's pretty impressive. But anyway, we'll go more into details this Saturday when we start discussing the specifics, but it's going to be available in 3 different colors, which is silver, gold, and space gray, and is going to be coming out this November. So now onto the event's headliner, and that is the iPhone 6S. It includes the new 7000 series aluminum with new color option of rose gold, a new force touch panel, which is now called a 3D touch panel, with tactile feedback from a Taptic Engine system, a new A9 chip, the new 12 megapixel EyeSight rear-facing camera, as well as the new 5 megapixel front-facing camera, and 2 times faster LTE and Wi-Fi connectivity. You are really tempting me here, Apple, if not for the fact that all this still comes with the base model of 16 gigabytes. Now, my problem with that is that having all these new camera updates with 12 megapixels in the rear, 5 megapixels in the front, 4K video shooting, as well as this new live photo feature which takes 3 second clips with each photo that you take, all these files are going to be taking up a lot of space on this phone now, a lot more than the 8 megapixel and the 1.3 I think it was on the iPhone 6. You really need more space than 16 gigabytes starting. Apple, like, why would you do this? It would be perfect if you started with a 32 gigabyte model right from the beginning. Again, I don't want to really get into it until Saturday, but so I'll save my anger and frustration for that video when I can talk with Iman. But Yeah, I mean, it came with a bunch of really other cool new features, like we had mentioned how using the front-facing camera, you would have a flash available with the panel itself lighting up. Apparently, there's this thing they're doing with it. It's going to be a True Tone flash as well, just like in the back, where the sensor is going to pick up ambient colors and flash the correct type of light to give you a better look, as well as having the ability to make that screen 3 times brighter than it could ever actually go, as like, so you could have a powerful flash even in really dark situations. And again, the phone comes with the new A9 processor, which is 70% faster in CPU tasks over the A8 processor, as well as being 90% faster in GPU tasks. It also comes with a built-in motion coprocessor that's always on, collecting your data while you're walking around for any of your like health tracking apps that you might use. Speaking of always on, they apparently went with the Google Now route of some of the Nexus devices where Siri is always activated. So at any point you can just say, "Hey Siri, do this for me," and it just picks up on it automatically. I mean, this is a pretty awesome feature, especially in like hands-free situations, like in your car. You never actually have to touch your phone again. You could just be sitting there driving around being like, "Hey Siri, do this for me, play this song for me, call this person," and it'll just do it for you. And that's it for the iPhone 6S, and I gotta say, I'm really impressed with the new features that it's coming with. And again, I am a little bit disappointed with Apple with the 16GB starting storage model, but you know, you can't get everything you want. So if you guys are interested in picking up the phone, the pre-order begins this Saturday, September 12th, and the phone will actually be available September 25th. Now, there was a lot of little extra facts and tidbits that I left out of this video that happened during the event, and that's because, like I had mentioned, this Saturday, Iman and I are gonna go into a deep discussion over everything, you know, talk about our pros and cons, what we did liked and didn't like, so please tune in for that. But if you want those facts now, I'm gonna include a link to a bunch of articles where you can get everything that happened at the event in the description below, so check those out. And again, thank you for joining me here on the Apple Pub. It was a pretty awesome event, even if there was no one more thing. And as always, please help support the channel out by hitting that like button if you like the video, subscribe if you want to catch more, and we'll see you again this Saturday. So until then, stay classy, Pupsters.